record,
or at least the last record.
Mm-hmm.
You had a more of a production, higher level production, I guess. How was that shift for you?
Yeah, it was a little different. Actually, it was a lot different, but it was maybe more akin to what, like, Ty Segall's used to.
Mm-hmm.
So it actually, I thought switching up what I usually did would be scary, but I'd worked with him before, so there was that trust there, uh-huh. You know. So it wasn't that scary. Yeah.
Was all the writing just you, or did Ty also participate?
It was all me.
Uh huh.
But yeah.
Do you still use the 4-track to write on?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
That was kind of like the whole genesis of it. Like, I had done it all on the 4-track up until that point,
mm-hmm.
and all those songs I did on the 4-track, but I didn't like the way they sounded. So it was kind of perfect storm, like, and he wanted to do it, and I was unhappy with what I had.
Uh-huh.
So it worked out well.
Why were you unhappy with it, I guess?
I don't know. It just didn't sound very good. I don't know why. Yeah.
Did you lose the 4-track mojo, you think? Previous records.
Maybe. Yeah. Yeah. Actually, I think it was because a lot of them, it was more stripped down,
mm-hmm.
and I thought they'd sound better with real drums and, you know, yeah. Because previous White Fence records, there's just a lot of layering going on, mm-hmm. you know, so these ones didn't have that, so I thought if it was recorded a little bit better, it might work,
mm-hmm.
yeah.
And was it easier? Because, you know, with 4-tracks, I guess you have to, because you record everything yourself, and I guess one thing at a time? Okay.
Yeah.
So sometimes it makes for some sort of weirdly shaped time frame music, I guess. Because, you know, it kind of enters its own universe and space, I would say. Do you agree?
Yeah, I do. And I would just have time to, like, nerd out and get lost in it, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Where, like, that's what scares me about the studio is that there's always someone there,
mm-hmm.
you know,
mm-hmm.
kind of like, and then like the clock's ticking, and you know,
uh-huh.
so you're under kind of pressure,
mm-hmm.
but that's why working with Ty is good, because we kind of have a similar mindset in that sense, where just kind of go and do it, and yeah.
Uh-huh. I've never met Ty, but is he like, in terms of as a producer, I mean, is he like, well, whatever, I don't know, or does he have some sort of you know, no, try it again, you can pull it off better or something?
No, he's not like that. He kind of, what's cool about him is, like, there's a mutual respect, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So if I do something, it's up to me if I like it or not,
mm-hmm.
you know, because
mm-hmm.
he respects it either way. It's not like that cliche, like, producer shit where it's like, I don't like that. We should try that again, you know.
Uh-huh.
Maybe practice more. Come back.
Uh-huh.
It's not like that.
Uh-huh.
Did you have any other experience with producers in the past?
Yeah.
Namely with, I guess, The Fall, I would imagine?
No.
No, not true.
No, no, that was self-produced.
Uh-huh.
Well, I guess Mark was the producer.
Yeah, Mark takes over everything, really, doesn't
he?
Yeah.
So, yeah.
There's no producers, obviously, in The Fall.
No way. Okay. Yeah,
of course.
Yeah.
Of course. While we're on The Fall, how did you end up playing in The Fall?
It's kind of a long story, but the short story is they had come over for a tour, and his band just quit on him,
mm-hmm.
and flew home after two shows, I think.
Mm-hmm.
So they were stuck in the States, and I'm pretty sure, like, it's hard to get a visa coming from there to the States.
Mm-hmm.
So they were like, we're gonna finish this tour no matter what, and which is kind of true Fall fashion, just like, fuck it, you know, Mark is The Fall, I'll mm-hmm. do whatever. So there's a mutual friend that put us in contact, because I was in a band then. And they hit us up. I was in a band called Darker My Love, and, like, so they called us to be the backup band.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, so we practiced for a couple days and then met them in San Diego.
Mm-hmm. Are you still on and off with The Fall?
Yeah.
Oh, OK.
Yeah, I actually did a tour, what, 2 years ago or something with them. Mm-hmm. They, like, needed their guitar player. I think his like, wife was having a baby, and they had a tour, so they called me up, and I flew out there. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay. And I guess that maybe the Fall are really pretty much used to, Mark is pretty much used to having to find musicians on the spot, I mm-hmm. guess, because either the band quits on him or he just
doesn't
like them and lets them go like a few hours before the show or something.
Yeah, yeah,
it's possible.
Much. Yeah, I feel fortunate that that hasn't happened to me.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mark digs you then.
Yeah.
Okay. Cool. But what was your experience like playing for them? Because it's a legendary band. Come on.
Yeah, it was a legendary experience.
And still is.
I don't know, I just kind of shut up and let him tell me what to do. It's his band, you know what I mean? Like, I'm not trying to, like, change it or anything, you know? Uh-huh. So I think maybe he respects that, you know? Uh-huh. I'll do whatever he wants, you know? Uh-huh. Yeah.
I don't mean to make this interview about the Fall, but how's he like giving instructions to other musicians? Does he really know, like, what he wants in terms of what you can do musically, or is he like, for instance, a Freddie Mercury that goes like, oh, don't go like boom boom chab, go like boom boom ch or something? Because he was like that.
Maybe
I don't know a lot about
a little bit of both. Maybe more like, fucking do that. Yeah, and then you do that.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. More of something else.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Cool. I saw an interview that you did, the What's in My Bag thing with the Amoeba Records.
Yeah.
That's in San Francisco, right?
That one was in L.A.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, but there is one in San Francisco. Okay. Yeah.
It's pretty cool. A cool store, right?
Very cool store.
Awesome.
Shout out to Amoeba.
Shout out to Amoeba.
Yeah.
I know no one of Amoeba, but there you go.
Definitely, it's amazing. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
And your record selection was really fun, I would say, because it was really across the map and some really cool stuff, like Negative Approach and stuff like that.
Yeah, yeah.
And proto-punk stuff that was really...
You can
tell that you would enjoy, I would say, but then mm-hmm. there's stuff like that isn't so... I mean, for people on a very immediate perception level, I would say, that mm-hmm. was, oh, he listens to hip-hop and stuff mm-hmm. like that. And one of the things you mentioned was Shabazz Palaces.
Yeah.
I actually interviewed the guys about pretty much a year ago, right here.
Cool.
Yeah. So,
yeah.
And Ishmael and Tendai were really, really nice. And you said that he was, you thought he was underrated? How so?
Because I think he was, well, one of the guys was in Digable Planets, right? Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Ishmael, yeah.
And that was like a very commercial group,
mm-hmm.
like, they, you know, especially that one song, and mm-hmm. I feel like maybe a lot of people who didn't know about where they'd come from
mm-hmm.
just probably thought they were maybe just as the same as, like, I don't know, you know, just mm-hmm. a pop rap group or something, but it's actually really good, and the record that came after that one was really amazing, and you could tell that they're, like, they're not just a commercial hip-hop group.
Oh, not at all.
No, not at all.
Hardly a hip-hop group, I would say.
Well, I know, yeah. They actually, like when they make comparisons to, like, bebop and, like, where hip-hop and mm-hmm. all that comes from, they are pretty, I feel like they really tapped into that, but kept it very modern.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
It's really out there.
Yeah, I just think it's, just artistic hip-hop, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And, yeah, it's just cool that still exists, and that moving it forward but keeping it kind of old school as well.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
They're
just two guys. Tendai does basically like 80% of the music, and pulls it off live. Like, I would say again, 80% of it.
Yeah.
It's really, really, really refreshing. Have you seen the Don?
It's like, it's just genuine and authentic. You know what I mean? And I guess that's what I was trying to say. Like, it wasn't just a commercial thing. They're actually, like, authentic
mm-hmm.
people,
mm-hmm.
you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Speaking of that, I'm Segway guy, I would say. But speaking of that, because with your ample music palette, what would you say that makes you play what you naturally play, or write and play and do what you naturally do? Like, what made you go that way instead of, why are you not doing a rap group?
I would say that's a really good question, because I was like a 11 when I was 11. I was like a gangster. Well, not really, but I dressed like that. I thought it was really cool, because you know, like NWA and Eazy-E and all that.
Yeah.
And yeah, I had like a King's hat and Cortez's. But I don't know. I think, but that was music that I really liked growing up. Uh-huh. But I also liked Guns N' Roses, so I don't know.
Who didn't?
Yeah, I don't know. Yeah. But I think it wasn't until like bands like Minor Threat and the Ramones is when I realized that, oh, this is music that I can play because I like guitar. Mm-hmm. You know?
Yeah.
And Nirvana. Know how to like rap or like do like DJ stuff, so I don't know, I just stuck with what I knew. Uh-huh. You know. Uh-huh.
And you're still you're basically a Fender guy in terms of guitars.
Oh, I guess so, yeah.
Were you always from the start?
Yeah, because Jimi Hendrix had one, but then I had an SG, a Gibson. I don't really know.
Oh, okay.
I'm not really anything guy.
Oh, okay, okay.
Yeah.
Because I've always seen you with Strats and mostly Jazzmasters, I
would
say.
Yeah. Well, that was just by luck. I don't really actually give one shit about gear.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
okay.
It's weird. I don't care. Okay. Everyone's like, oh, cool stuff. I don't care.
Whatever,
I don't give a fuck, yeah. Okay. But my friend got that guitar modified, and I just like the way it sounded.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And I was gonna ask.
I appreciate gear.
Oh, okay. Okay.
So, I really do.
So there's no disdain.
But I just don't.
For gear,
I just don't know anything about it.
Oh, okay.
I'm ignorant to it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So whatever is in the studio or whatever you're.
Yeah. Yeah. I could. Yeah. Try to make anything sound cool, no matter what it is. You know.
Uh huh. Uh-huh.
Yeah.
So you do you go for looks or really the sound of things? Or do you go for looks when you?
A little bit of both.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So what's
to be honest with you,
what's the coolest looking guitar?
Well, mine.
Oh, of course, obviously. Yeah, stupid question.
No, I don't know. Actually, those big Gibson 335s are cool.
Oh, those are awesome.
I like the way those look, but I tried to rock one. I was at Guitar Center, and I tried it on, and it looked weird. So,
okay.
So I won't be playing that. Thank you.
Okay.
Yeah.
In the Like That video, you break this guitar on this guy's back.
Yeah.
Did that really happen? Or
yeah, I was really in jail, and and they came in, and they were doing a reality show on me, and I got mad. I broke the guitar on the man.
Mm,
okay. On the security guard, he's such a dick.
So no breaking the fourth wall here.
Yeah. No, I just got out of jail, and I'm doing this tour. It's like a probation thing. So
okay,
yeah.
So is that what the record is really about?
Yeah. I'm free.
So it's not necessarily about, because I thought it was about other people because of the title, but apparently it's autobiographical thing.
Yeah, it's about me. Fresh out of jail. Yeah.
What did you learn?
Really happy to be here. Yeah.
I bet. What did you learn in jail?
How to make music videos.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So are there many directors in jail?
Yeah, there was two.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. What? Why were they in?
Why were they in? They were innocent.
Oh, okay.
So.
Good answer.
Yeah.
Nice one.
Yeah.
Good job.
Yeah, thank you.
You're welcome. This is the first time you're playing in Portugal, or is it just, because I don't really recall you playing before.
We played Porto before.
How did you find Porto?
Oh, it was amazing. It's beautiful.
And what about Lisbon? I should always ask, because you know, people come to Lisbon and have the first impression, I guess. What's your first impression?
It's like a very European San Francisco.
Oh, okay. I've never been. Actually, my sister used to live in San Francisco, and she used to tell me this is actually not that dissimilar because of the heights and stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
And apparently the humidity today.
Oh yeah.
Oh okay, but it's colder in San Francisco, I guess.
Yeah, definitely. Okay. Yeah.
Playing Primavera next.
Yeah,
I'll be there next week.
Cool.
And I decided to do it over here because I would. Mm-hmm. Have you played there? Have you been there?
Yeah, we played Primavera 2 years ago, I think.
Okay.
Yeah, played there with the Fall too before that.
Uh huh.
Yeah, but with White Fence, yeah, 2 years ago.
Okay. Okay. The Fall one, I saw that. So
really,
because I've been there. This is going to be my 7th year in a row there. I think we
played 2007. Or something, maybe. 2008.
The Fall have played since, I think.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. But I didn't do those ones.
Oh, that's the difference. Okay, yeah. Okay. So, but, you know, Primavera, to me, is like the best festival ever.
Yeah, I think so. Definitely.
So, and what do you remember of Primavera? Because it's a bit of a fun haze to me, always. I don't know anything anymore.
Fun Haze, I remember that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I don't know.
They were really good, Fun Haze.
Fun Haze was sick that night.
They always play.
Yeah.
Like Shellac.
Yeah.
The Fun Haze are always there.
Yeah. I don't remember much, although I know there was a lot of great bands. Uh-huh. I don't remember fucking any of them. And it was a very well-organized festival.
Mm-hmm.
Like, there's a reason why I feel like people want to go mm-hmm. and why people want to play it, because
mm-hmm.
it's just really good.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I think the vibe is like anything, nothing else, I mean.
Yeah. You're talking about the Barcelona one, right?
Yeah. The Porto one's really good, but it's really different. Good
too.
Yeah.
We played that, and that was really good, too.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Oh, so cool.
Yeah.
Awesome. And I had one thing to ask you.
Okay.
It was that
you may.
Okay, thank you very much for your kindness, sir. but White Fences do.
Fence.
Yeah, but White Fences in general, I mean.
Oh, okay.
So that's another question. Is it a white fence in particular, or is it a white fence that is symbolic of all white fences?
Probably symbolic of all, yeah.
Okay, there you go. There you go. So that's relevant.
Okay.
And what do white fences, or one white fence in particular, makes you feel like? So does it give you like this sensation of comfort, I would say?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Or hiding something. Or security. Or false security.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Because basically you just need an axe and there you go. And you're on the other side.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
And axes are all around everywhere.
You just kind of, hop over it. Yeah, I guess.
Is it? Yeah. Is your white fence not that tall then?
Oh, I don't have one.
Oh, in your mind, I not really physical white fence.
Oh, my like symbolic spiritual white fence?
Yes, your spirit animal white fence.
Hmm.
That's stupid. That's dumb. A spirit animal white fence.
No, that's good.
Yeah,
my spirit animal's a white fence. What was the question?
I don't know anymore. Birth Records, I should ask, how come it exists just to release one artist?
Oh, because
Jessica Pratt.
I never thought about like starting a label, just because it sounds like too much trouble,
mm-hmm.
and I'm not good at math really,
mm-hmm.
so,
which is fine.
Yeah, but Jessica, I heard her music and I had to do it. Like it was a crime against the universe that her music wasn't out
mm-hmm.
into the world. So I just was like, I'll do it. I don't care.
Awesome.
Like whatever it takes, kind of thing. But then. I realized that, oh, cool, I could have, like, a home for any other music that I wanted to put out, maybe, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's a good enough reason, of course.
Yeah, like, that's why I put the Drinks record out on that. It was, like, a record I did with Cate LeBon.
Uh-huh.
It's kind of like a passion projects only kind of thing, uh-huh. you know what I mean?
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
That's awesome that you're in a place that you can do that.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah, it's cool. Uh-huh. Yeah. I never wanted to, but...
What you really wanted was to have a hip-hop group. Yeah.
Yeah, what I really wanted was a hip-hop group. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Still do. Yeah.
Here's a tip to all A&Rs. And stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. So I got to ask you, I don't have to, but I will. So it's probably judging on the cadence of past releases, you'll probably have something coming up, more or less. Yeah. Well, when's it due? Do you have a name?
Oh, okay. So, Kayla Bond.
Okay.
She actually produced, we recorded a record of my songs, and she produced it. Drag City's gonna put it out, and I think... Oh, this is good. I can plug it.
Sure. Because, plug everything you want.
I have to because it's not going to be White Fence. It's going to be Tim Presley, and which I never wanted to do.
Mm-hmm.
But I feel like it was her idea.
Okay.
By the way.
Okay.
But I thought also
she forced you into it. Then.
Yeah. Okay, yeah. Yeah. Okay, because that's what producers do. They force you to do things.
Sure.
No.
unless they're Thai.
Yeah. No. But Cate is amazing. It's Ty and Cate are both incredible and amazing at nurturing, like producing, I guess, but in different ways.
Mm-hmm.
You know.
Yeah.
What was I saying? Oh yeah, but she thought it would be wise to do it under my name, Tim Presley.
Okay.
And I agree because it sounds very different than White Fence.
Oh.
So I feel like it wouldn't be fair to do that.
Uh-huh.
To name it a White Fence record.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah.
How's it different then? How would you say it's difficult to describe? I could imagine. Yeah,
I don't know, man. It's just different. I don't even know.
Uh-huh.
It just doesn't sound like a White Fence album, you know.
Hmm.
It's very stripped down and dry.
Okay,
and
that's
different.
Good. That's good enough. That's good enough. A good enough of a tease, I would say. To understand.
Yeah.
Cool. Awesome.
Yeah,
awesome.
Yeah.
Thanks, man. Thanks for your time.
Thank you.
And I'll see you later and at Primavera, I would say.
Cool.
Yeah, next week. Thanks, man. Thanks for your time.
Yeah, thank you.
This was lovely.
Yeah, it was lovely. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, no, thank you.